Very good day. Long, long ago when I was in school, we had a school play, a drama of Shakespeare's Julius Caesar. I was given the privilege of playing the role of Julius Caesar. And we had this fantastic English literature teacher who would eat, drink, live literature. So he wanted to ensure that I get into the spirit of that role. So he started explaining to me. The scene went like this, that Julius Caesar had developed a lot of enemies in his own Senate, among his own people. And they were out to eliminate him. And the soothsayer also, the astrologer, had said, beware the Ides of March. 15th of March is the day on which, you know, people will attack you. And it was 15th March. On that day, Caesar's wife said, don't go. Don't go to the Senate because you've got these enemies and this threat. And Caesar, that was, I had to memorize and read out those words, which said, cowards die many times before their death. The brave taste of death but once. I will go, he said. And he went. And he was assassinated, and that was the end of the of Julius Caesar. But as he rightly said, cowards die many times before their death. Julius Caesar tasted death once. Now, I don't know if there's anybody present over here who is expecting not to taste death. If you have found the elixir or the vaccination of immortality, then it is fine. But other than that, death is
inevitable.
Okay, so challenges come. See, if you were as old as me, you would have experienced, we had wars. We had earthquakes, we had tsunamis, we had horrible riots and entire city would go under curfew. We had so many such times when lives were at threat, lives were being put to threat. And many a time on those occasions people said, no, let's not step out, let's keep ourselves protected, let's not go in that area, let's not do this, let's not do that. Fine. I appreciated, I told them that yes, we should take precaution when this sort of thing is happening. Even medically, we had so many pandemics like this. Those of you who are old enough will recollect how much the HIV AIDS scare was there. Every second person, people were scared to go to the barber because they thought that if that blade has been used on somebody who is HIV positive, etc., etc. So nothing new. We have gone through all these. You can ask anybody who has lived enough number of years in this world. But this time, for whatever the reason, I feel that it is not the coronavirus or the COVID-19, it is not the pandemic, it is not the lockdown, it is the way we have locked our minds. The unlocking has already started. The same authorities who were not only telling us, but were penalizing us if we step out of the house, were strictly enforcing certain restrictions, are today telling us that yes, step by step, we are allowing you to come out. But where is the thing? I recollect my friends who travel by auto. The day the government said autos can go around, they couldn't find a single auto. 1, 2, 3, 4 days, sometimes they were struggling and they said that we are just not able to get an auto. Now, the same auto rickshaw people who had spent 2 months without any income, as you know, an auto rickshaw driver earns by the day, he's like a daily wage earner. So, for 2 months he had no income. And the day the government said that there is no restriction, you can go ahead, and the passengers are there standing on the road looking for an auto, the auto rickshaw drivers refuse to come out for days together. So that is what I meant by saying that somewhere along the line, we have now developed a pandemic of locking our mind and not wanting to take a chance. On the flip side of it, let me tell you something interesting. A friend of mine who is a dentist, I was casually asking her that, you know, are you planning also to reopen your clinic? She said, I opened my clinic 3 weeks back. I said, hey, everybody is so scared, and particularly dentists and things like that, how are you doing? She said, you know something, the chances of my getting corona from the vegetable vendor when I go to buy my vegetables are 100 times more than my getting corona from my patient. It's as simple as that. So left, right and center, somewhere along the line, I have been a little concerned in the last 2-3 weeks that people have locked up their minds and now they are refusing to come out. One of the areas of my deep concern is the education system. The only thing that is being debated, there is a total divide, like how it happens in elections, you are either BJP or you are Congress or something of that sort. So there is this total divide between people who want to send their children to school and who don't want to send their children to school. And of course, you know who is in the majority. Fair enough. As a parent, if you want to protect your child and not send your child outside where there is a risk of a virus, I respect your wishes and your love for your child. But I don't hear a single person talking about what should be the alternate education system. Is it only restricted to sitting in front of the laptop or the phone and the teacher going on, talking, and you have to sit and listen? Is that what is learning? Is that what is education? Why have we closed our minds to even considering what is education for our child, learning for the child? And this in a country which for thousands of years boasted the great Gurukul system, an amazing system where the child was left in the hands of the guru, and the guru taught him all the life skills.
They lived there.
They lived with the guru. They had to learn the etiquette of their household. They had to help the guru with the household tasks. They had to get along with others. They had 20 so-called siblings who were guru brothers and guru sisters with them. From sword fighting to cutting vegetables to chanting mantras, everything was taught to them. Once they learned all the basic life skills, then they went back home. And they learned vocational skills. So if he was a farmer's son, he would learn plumbing. If he was a carpenter's son, he would learn carpentry when he came to that age. But the basic learning, basic education for thousands of years was that. And even today, even when there is a compulsion because of the lockdown or whatever has been happening, nobody is even giving a second thought to it. So that is my request, which I want to present and to stimulate your mind to thinking, whether it is staying back home and not stepping out, whether it is sending your child to school or providing alternative learning to the child. I keep getting reminded of that wonderful quote of Amir Khan in the movie Three Idiots, and he tells his director, he has the guts to tell him, sir, even a lion, when he is whipped, he goes and sits on the stool. But we call that lion well-trained. We do not call that lion well-educated. So you are whipping your children and making them write down the answers, and we are saying that they are well-educated. Don't we have some concern for our children beyond this basic concern of protecting the child from the coronavirus? And as you know, the coronavirus can come within a minute. A passerby, somebody who is standing close to you, that delivery boy who comes, or that vegetable vendor, or this or that, somewhere or the other, within minutes, or not even somebody whom you have touched, somebody who has touched this, then I go and touch it and I get it. And it is so rampant. What is it that we are running away from? I remember more than 100 years back in the city of Hyderabad, where my maternal grandfather lived, he was a civil engineer. One day there was a panic. Even without our social media, there was this huge this thing. Within minutes, it spread all over the city. There's a small little river, Musi River, which runs in between the city. And one fine morning, there were hundreds and thousands and tens of thousands of people on the road saying, the river is overflowing, we are going to get flooded, run. run there. People from south of the city were running to the north. People from north of the city were running south. East was running to west. West was running to east. My grandfather, as I said, was a civil engineer. He just took a piece of paper and he calculated. He said that Musi is on this height. The area where he lived, you know, Himatnagar was at this height. He said for the water to reach from here to here, they will require so many million cubic feet of water, which he said that if all the rivers in the state also overflow, we will not have that much river. So there's no question of the river coming to my house. And he turned to his wife and said, get me a nice hot cup of tea. Let's sit and watch all these fools running around the place. As simple as that. But now, things have really changed. At that time, there was just people running around and carrying out these rumors. Today, social media has taken over. 20-25 years back, experts told us that henceforth, wars will be won and lost by the media and not by the guns. That was proven by one simple incident, if you could recall those days. America said that Iraq has got weapons of mass destruction, and they turned the whole tide of the world against Iraq. And finally, when this so-called great dictator, the person with all these weapons of mass destruction, when that fellow was caught in a bunker in a cubbyhole with one small revolver in his hand, and he had nothing else. But the world opinion had already formed in Iraq. He was eliminated only by that, not a single gunshot was fired. Can we not learn lessons from this? Why are we allowing the media, social media, whatever it is? We start our day with how many died, how many infected, how many what, and we end our day with that. Very soon I have a feeling that all the other gods will get over and there will be only Corona Mata. Everybody will be praying only to that. I'm waiting for temples to come up now, you know, saying that we will not go to the other temples, we will go only to Corona Mata temple because, you know, everything is dependent on that. I'm saying this in a lighter way, but I do want you to please give a serious thought to this. Why have we locked up our minds into this COVID or this pandemic or this lockdown or whatever? It is. Why can we not use a simple bit of our own logic, our own thinking process to analyze what is right and what is wrong? What is the definition of protection? I give a simple example to parents that when your child was a few months old and for the first time wanted to get up and walk, you knew that he cannot walk, his limbs are not strong enough. But despite knowing that he is going to fall, you encouraged him to get up. And what happened? He got up. He took two steps, on the third step he fell down. If at that time you had told him, stupid fellow, why do you want to walk and hurt yourself? You tell me, I'll carry you around. That would have been the end of his development, right? But we didn't do that. We even did things like, you know, hitting the floor and saying, bad floor, floor has hurt you, no, don't worry, I will punish the floor, come on now, get up and walk. Second time, third time, fifth time, the child does not walk, and the fear was over. So what my request to you is, let us not be governed by one four-letter word.
Fear.
We normally do not talk about F, asterisk, asterisk, asterisk. So now it is F, E, A, R. Let us not get governed by fear. Yes, a certain amount of fear is necessary, I don't deny that. Even in the military, they say that a soldier who claims to have no fear at all is a very dangerous soldier. He will risk his own life and he will risk the lives of his comrades. So when the soldier faces the enemy, if he says, yes sir, there is this little thing in my chest, you know, a little tightening and that little anxiety or something. But then I overcome it and I move forward. But imagine a soldier who is so overwhelmed with fear that he doesn't want to face the enemy. There's a wonderful proverb that says, a ship is safest in the harbor. But that is not where it was meant to be, right? You can keep your ship in the harbor, 100% guarantee that ship will not sink. That's not what a ship is meant to do. You can keep your children, your loved ones and yourself 24 hours in the harbor of your apartment. But that's not what life is meant to be. You cannot deteriorate your quality of life. As it is, the economy, as you know, of the country, of the world, has taken such a bad beating. That's another area where people are hardly talking about it. Only when I talk to individuals and then they say that, you know, my salary has been cut down to half, or I've lost my job, or I've lost my business or something of that sort, and then they start coming out with their anxieties at a one-to-one level to a counselor. But otherwise, everybody is putting on a grey face. People are not even, you know, visualizing. And it's not just our economy. We as a country may still be doing well, but don't forget that we are dependent on so many other countries' economies. The IT sector, which, you know, is one of the best money spinners in cities like Bangalore and all that, is so heavily dependent on other countries. It's entirely export based. And if those countries have an economic fallout, how much will it affect us? Are we looking into that? So we have to find a middle path. We cannot allow fear to, you know, govern our lives. We have to ensure that we strike a balance. And that balance can be struck only if we unlock our minds, pull out this horrible fear. I would not even say fear, it is a paranoia. It is, you know, that pathological fear, that as though the moment I step out, there's a monster or a demon, you know, standing outside to grab hold of my child and run away with him or something of that sort. Once we overcome that, then we can start thinking rationally, whether it's in terms of employment and work, whether it's in terms of protection, whether it's in terms of education and learning for the children. All these can be done if we change our mindset. That is my only request to you.